Charles Mwangu Shampagi. Tonight we'll be having a discussion that focuses on women, and a discussion that will only have men discussing women involvement in politics, in social life and economic life, and especially the question of domestic violence and who should be at the forefront of challenging this. We missed, of course, the discussion on Women's Day, and now 15 days later, it's March 15th, we'll be having that discussion. Chris, let me start with you. Thank you very much for stepping in last Sunday.
Very inconveniencing.
Eh? What was the inconvenience?
I was not speaking.
You're not speaking. I was told about your constraint. Yes, people who were watching told me how much constrained you were.
To give them time to do their thing.
Thank you very much. So my colleague Chris Obore needs no more introduction. Arthur Larock is Country Director, ActionAid, Uganda.
Yeah.
Arthur, very nice to have you here.
Thank you very much.
And of course, veteran journalist, Corporate Affairs Director of Nile Breweries, S.A.B. Miller. Onapito,
so the guest panelists are all directors.
Yes, big man.
I'm not a director.
I want to start with Arthur and ask, we're having a discussion when women have been at the center of a lot of discussion in this country over the last few days. One thing we need to pick from is the FDC did a launch of a new policy agenda on Monday. The keynote speaker was not just a woman, but a young woman in Ann Adeke Ebaju. And people have given her plaudits for her speech, for her keynote address. The other was a major speech from the Secretary General of the FDC, Ali Salasso. At the center was seated the chairperson of FDC in the Rubaga division chairperson,
Sebugwao
Joyce. And that was the structure. But you also have a lot of debate now around parliament and the decision by the speaker, who's also a woman, executed by the clerked parliament, who is also a woman. What is the situation of women in this country, especially the question about domestic violence and how it fits in what is outwardly seen as social progression, political progression, and economic progression of women in this country?
Well, thank you. It's interesting the example you start with. For many, they might be surprised at that example you bring. But the truth is, many people don't look at women as equal, if you like. Human beings who can do all that you have talked about. So there is, in fact, as you speak, there is a tone of surprise that, you know, can you imagine the keynote was this young lady, then the Secretary General, then the chairperson. Now, what's wrong with that? There's absolutely nothing wrong, because we've come a long way with this appreciation that women can occupy space and actually perform to the expectation. And so it's gratifying to put that out the way you've done and just prove that women can do it.
But are you surprised that we have a panel of all men discussing women in politics?
I am not surprised. I am not surprised at all. In fact, I am happy about that, because I firmly believe that the struggle for total emancipation of women is not something that can happen just by women. I believe that women should be in the lead of their own, you know, liberation, if you will. But, you know, we are living in a world, especially in our context, a highly patriarchal society. Patriarchy sometimes, you know, legitimizes and justifies sometimes oppression against women. And, you know, all the information that is available, whether it's about domestic violence, to a large extent, it is something that is couched in this patriarchal setup where masculinity, where domination of politics, of social life, of economic life is something done by men. And so the belief, therefore, that patriarchy is a system that of itself simply subjugates women. And I think women and men that live in this patriarchal society, yeah, tend to be socialized in that manner.
I'm going to get sometimes stretched. Chris, I need you to come into this discussion now. Do you think the women have stepped up to the plate of the demands of the political situation we find ourselves in, especially looking at the examples that I started with? Maybe let me start with this. You surprised that a panel of only men starts a discussion on women?
I don't know whether I should be surprised or not. But the topic is, I think you're putting there, is women in politics.
Mm-hmm.
My understanding is, if you're talking about women, I think even this discussion could stereotype women. You would imagine women are those weak people who should be defended. I don't think that is a good way to look at them. What is politics? Essentially, politics is who gets what. So if you want women in politics, you're saying you want women to take charge of the distribution of economic benefits, isn't it? And if that's what you want them to take charge of, I'm presuming that you're questioning that why are they not in charge? It's because it's a contest when it comes to distribution. But beyond just having women occupy positions, do we see women distribute resources? Because when you look at vulnerability aspects in any given, especially in third world countries, it is children and women who are most affected by vulnerability. We have just heard women, the song in this country, that women have been liberated, women now can sit in higher echelons, women can be vice presidents, women can be ministers.
Can be speaker. Can be clerk.
So how much money has the speaker, for instance, by virtue of being a speaker, how much has she allocated to maternal health? How much has she allocated to education of a girl child? How much has the speaker given to water? Because these are all areas where women face suffering. They say men batter women. True. Why? A man comes drunk, wants hot water. How much money have we put into piped water? How much tax are we putting into water heaters? Such that if water is in a house which is hot, there is no reason for a man to ask a woman to boil water at 2 a.m. So these are areas where you want to liberate a woman by actually providing those necessities that make man expose a woman to abuse. But we have a Minister of Trade. How has it helped women who are trading? We have just had a Minister of Finance, actually the one responsible for allocating resources. To what point did she allocate money to the education of a girl child? To giving them sanitary pads? Because if you want to liberate a woman, it is not enough to just pick them. Mm-hmm. As I say, bring them on the dining table,
mm-hmm,
so that if they are there, and Arthur LaRocque, the big man in ActionAid, wants to make a decision. But when he sees somebody with two breasts, he says, hey, by the way, there are also women here. That's one way, that you want them there to remind men that there is a woman. But it should not be that. It should actually be that if women are there, they should actually take charge of their own affairs. But do we see them prioritizing that? So we want the women to be liberated. We as who?
Mm-hmm.
Women should not be liberated according to how we men see. How do women see their liberation? What do they want?
A lot of those questions Arthur needs to respond to. Let me jump quickly to Ona. We are in a political situation. And like Chris says, tokenism, appreciation of women. So if FDC, for example, parades three women as shining lights in the party, you say, maybe women are being recognized. And then you go back, you go down into the policy agenda that was presented, and you find clear policy position on how women should be. But that is what the NRM has been riding on for the last so many years. UPC claims it, has it in its party platform. The DP claims we have women. Is that enough? Does a discussion like this, like Chris argues, continue the stereotyping of women, especially in the political context?
Look, Charles, I tend to disappoint women activists, feminists, and all this, because I'm one person who believes that the place of a woman is the most natural thing in society. In fact, right from biblical times, the Garden of Eden and what have you. As someone born by a woman, someone married to a woman, someone who is a father to a woman of the future, I always struggle sometimes with this tendency to stretch the women as separate from men, as people who really must be seen almost like you see a child on a political stage and you would be surprised. I would be surprised, but not to see a woman. Because for me, a woman is as natural as a man in whatever position she occupies. Of course, women get abused as men also get abused. Women get disadvantaged as men get. But I also believe that throughout history, many times when women struggle, when we go to war, when we go to war, there is always a woman in our lives. And it's also not fair for advocates of women to try and separate women from the problems of our society, from even causing this problem.
I believe even
where there have been political, let's say, when there have been bad governments, women have also been part of it, you know? Guys who cause problems have wives. And often, these wives, historically, have also been known to be part of the problem, you know? Not actually checking their husbands, not checking their sons.
Or encouraging
even
them
even encouraging excesses. You talk of corruption. Women cannot be removed from corruption, even if they are not in offices. Because they are part and parcel of the families that are perpetuating corruption. So that's not to say that we should not give women their fair share in life. But I don't want this dichotomy between women and men being perpetuated, that women are so disadvantaged, women have no role in society. It's sometimes just another bit of politics.
Why do you think that grows in the politics?
Because it's also becoming a bit of an industry.
Yes, you're going to see a lot more of that, especially as we begin the serious role of the political times of this country.
Yeah.
I mean, going into elections, you're going to have a lot of focus on women. What do you have as the women's agenda? What are you providing?
It's more like what Obore is trying to highlight, that is also a bit of political opportunism to appear to be fighting for women as a specific group. I think you should fight for society in which women are actually a very important part of society. They are the foundation of society. So women's problems and men's problems should not be separated, in my view.
Arthur, there are lots of things that are coming back to you. That this claim about patriarchy is actually an entrenchment of what activists appear to be fighting against in terms of bringing the women. I mean, looking at the women as some vulnerable group that needs men's assistance to be able to get to where. That's the argument that Chris was raising, and I think Honor rises very well. That when you begin focusing a discussion that talks about women, that creates those artificial boundaries between society, you're actually perpetuating that I am the knight in shining armor that's coming to liberate these women. President Museveni has done it very effectively and says, before we came in, the women, where were they? And then people begin arguing, no, it was 1985 conference in Nairobi, which Mama Mary Obote attended, that was bringing women on board. No, it was the Beijing conference in 1995 that brought women closer to the discussion. No, it is the 1.5 additional marks for government, I mean for entering to university. This is actually a perpetuation of the patriarchy. It's not a solution to women's challenges, because the challenges that women face are the same challenges that the rest of society faces, be it political, social, economic. Where do you draw the distinction?
You see, the truth that we cannot run away from is that patriarchy is for real. You can't deny that.
Where is the manifestation?
That we live in a world largely that is male dominated. Male control of power. If you take an example of domestic violence, for instance, a subject that you mentioned earlier, so 79% of cases of domestic violence in this country is perpetuated by men against women. Now, that is a fact.
And who perpetuates the 21%?
That is a fact.
Who perpetuates the 21% that remains?
79, that leaves you with only 19.
19%.
Yeah, of course, that also happens between the same gender. That's so. We cannot deny the fact. that when we talk about the dignity, choice, opportunity that exists in our context, they are not equally distributed. And therefore, the struggle to challenge patriarchy and what it comes with is a legitimate one. Now, I do not disagree with I do believe that women are as capable as men. But I do not think that the struggle and the emancipation of women is a cause that only women should be involved in, because it is not
the struggle for women. And I think
it's the struggle
no
for society. Yeah.
Maybe Chris can help. Mm. I do not think there is a disagreement on this table about what you're arguing.
Mm.
The question is, if you isolate it, wanna argue that, if you isolate it and talk about women emancipation, you actually helping matters. Instead, is Chris, was that your argument?
Yeah, you see, Arthur is not explaining what we are disagreeing with.
Mm.
Neither is he wrong. Patriarchy exists. What we are disagreeing with is the approach to remedy it.
Mm.
And indeed, domestic violence, 79%, regardless who made the statistics, we have also known that figures are political. So we don't want to get to that discussion. But let's go with the 79%.
Mm.
Whoever did it, what the motivation was, we don't know.
Mm.
But then, if it is true, according to this figure, 79% of people, men beat their wives.
Mm-hmm.
They do that. Now, what would be the solution? The solution is not saying women are made vulnerable. The solution should be, the research should be, why do 79% of the men perpetuate violence?
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm a policy interventionist, I would then bring a policy that cures man from aggression against a woman. And if you go to the villages, me, I'm a peasant. I come from a village. I don't drive. I was not born in any of the suburbs of Kampala.
Mm.
So if I looked at that understanding in our villages, sometimes there's no food. Food is not enough. Sometimes the man wants hot water. He has come late. Wants the woman to give him hot water to bathe. Sometimes there's a woman's gomas is also the bed sheet, you see? So because man cannot address that, he unleashes it on a woman. What would I do then? If it is water, those who say they love women in the parliament, in the cabinet, should be saying every household must have piped water. Every house, let's lower the taxes on water heaters. If a man is beating woman because he has failed to boil water.
Mm.
Now, you are making an intervention which gives a man no excuse to beat a woman. But what are we doing? We are rhetoric.
But what ordains a man to beat the woman?
Hold on. I'm saying, by the way, even in the USA, men beat women. It's a degree that varies. So don't go to issues of character now. You're not accused of that. We are looking at removing all excuses for a man to beat a woman. So what remains will be a matter of upbringing, will be a matter of character, will be a matter of choice, which, if I was a policymaker, I would still cure by exposing this girl to robust education, so that she can make decisions, she can make choices on even who the man she should marry should be. So unfortunately, our education system is collapsing while the politicians are making stupid noise that we liberated women. You know, women are doing this. They are dropping out of school.
Mm.
And after he has been talking the same thing, ActionAid, actually, how girl children are dropping out of school. That should be a point of concern. If this man comes from Gulu, we say Gulu, not Gulu.
Mm-hmm.
Gulu is for you, Mutoro. He comes from Gulu.
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you, from Natete, this Kawempe, tell me where there is a public toilet, where an actual woman going to Gulu will say, I want to ease myself, let me go and my dignity is respected. But the same people who liberated the women are saying, haven't you seen the Gulu at Yaka Road? We have done it. So they have ignored that this woman who travels needs to get out of the bus, go ease herself with dignity, come back. So women are made, she's swinging there, men are peeping from the window. This is the kind of thing we are giving to women. And we are saying, we have liberated what? Our women. So
we need to take a quick break, ladies, gentlemen. Let's take a quick break. When we come back, we'll be focusing more primarily on the politics of women involvement and the broader politics that have dominated the discussions over the last 1 week. We'll be right back. Welcome back. You're still watching The Fourth Estate, and we're discussing women in politics, but also discussing the broad issues that do the gender divide between men and women, both in economic and social issues. He was talking about decency.
Look,
you argued, and I think I agree with you, on the question of allocation of resources to liberate or to move society generally on a higher plane. You talked about women involvement. Corruption cannot be one thing. The woman wants to drive a better car, to have her children go to a better school, so she pushes the man, if the man is in that position of influence, to be corrupt. If the man is in a position of power, the entire family, not the woman now, the entire family is feeding off that power and want to keep enjoying that. Mm-hmm. So you can't separate and say, this is women, this is children, this
Absolutely.
Is men.
Yeah.
The argument sometimes pushed by the activists and trying to elevate this discussion and say, no, look at societal problems in a much broader sense, and then you'll be able to address everyone's problems. Because a man who has enough money to drink Malois and also leave have food at home is not going to batter the woman because the sales from last week's market sales have not all come to him. Is that an argument that fits into the discussion?
Absolutely. First of all, I must make a disclaimer here that woman is the greatest thing that ever happened to men. So that is...
Isn't that the problem?
Why do you say happened to men? You see,
no.
Framing, then it's right.
Just wait, to the world and
yeah,
men.
Now you see a point.
Because
now.
Sometimes when you are seen to be criticizing the world, feminism and what, people don't actually understand that women are the anchor of society, the anchor of the world. And I think for me the point is, I'm really not a big fan of whether it's a man or a woman in a position. I'm a fan of excellence. And if we can have women who can do better things, I wouldn't mind women leadership, but if they are not good, they shouldn't be there. If a man is not good, he shouldn't be there.
You just don't tolerate mediocrity.
Absolutely.
Don't tolerate corruption and other vices of whoever is leader.
So I'm actually not a big fan of affirmative action, so to say. Because we have seen women in positions and they haven't helped the situation. We have seen perhaps much more of men in positions and they haven't helped the situation. So let's strive for people who can address the problems of this society, whether they are men or women. To try and simplify it and say we need a woman there, we need a man there, will not solve anything.
Feminists argue on
because we have, for example, education. We have girls-only schools that are mediocre, always with the headmistress. We have boys-only schools which are mediocre with the headmaster. For all the decades there have been in existence.
Feminists argue and say, the problem is you haven't given the women the same opportunities men
have. No, I've just given you an example of a school. There are schools in this country which are girls only with a headmistress with all the years they have been in existence, but their performance has never changed. On the other hand, you have boys only schools with a man as a head. So it's not really about
Charles,
the sex. It's about the capacity of the person, but more importantly, about the institutions, you know, and how they are checked, checks and balances. All human beings, in my view, are inherently weak, inherently selfish. They need to be checked, man or woman.
You see, this thing, feminist, where do feminists come from? Where do they, you see, You can't be a man without a woman. Neither can you be a woman without a man. Mm. It is simple logic. It is people who are opportunistic, who are trying to coin things to create that dichotomy I was talking about. Mm. Obore wouldn't be Obore without his mother. No. Neither can my wife be my wife without her father. Mm. So you cannot keep saying this, that. The point, Charles, is that the greatest friend to a man is a woman. The worst enemy to a man is a woman. Similarly, the greatest friend to a woman is a man. And her greatest enemy is a man. So what does it call for? How do you use your womanhood? Simple as that. Those who use your womanhood well will interact well with man. And those who use it badly will interact badly with a man. So he's a man.
Is it as simple as that?
Yes, it's as simple as that. There are women who are very happy with their husbands. They don't even know what you are talking about.
And
there are men. There are men who are dying in the house. They are men, but actually they are women. Where the woman is, you see, the man is there talking, but he's really a woman. So you cannot tell these things. Society is complex. So the point here is, it is important for us to address issues that promote well-being. This is the most important thing. If we are concerned about a woman, our concern should be her well-being. And what's well-being? Her life, her dignity, her freedom, her choice, all that.
Okay.
And therefore, the policy intervention should be, how do you intervene and ensure that the outcome helps a woman? Mm-hmm. And fortunately, even the others here know, the activists, they have a role to play. But sometimes my problem is, whose agenda does an activist serve? They are defining a woman as that American stubborn woman. So they must bring it to an African
not
woman.
Not all American women.
Whatever it
women.
Is. Mm. That's
important.
Let me tell you, it's important. As that woman. Mm. But you see, things are contextual. It is contextual. So what has happened now, because of feminism, activism, the more cantankerous a woman is, the more she seems to be a woman. And they say, yeah, continue with your cantankerousness. Let's not promote cantankerousness and quality.
Okay.
Okay,
definitely. Now, I think we should not trivialize the injustices women face. It doesn't help. I think if you think about, let me just give you a really simple example. Or a village man who has to make hard choices, and this guy says, well, I will invest, I will send my son to school and leave this my daughter at home. Because I think that is a wiser investment to make. How many times do we hear these real life stories? I think the reality I talked about earlier, about socialization that tends to denigrate women. It's very fancy to talk about, no, everything, women and men, we need one another. Yeah, that's nice. Everybody will agree that. But the truth is, do the women folk have the same opportunity that men have? The answer is no.
The argument I was picking from Chris and Honor is, why put the emphasis on giving this same man, this same village folk, the hard choice to choose between a son and a daughter? Why not focus on getting him to a level where he doesn't have to make that difficult decision?
In other words, why don't you make UPE operational?
No, let me tell you. You see, we are not living in an ideal world. We are living in a world in which power is constructed in a particular way. Those who are able to control power make decisions in accordance with all sorts of motivations. And so, if this gentleman I'm talking about in a village has to make a choice, and people make choices every single day, what is it that enters into his head and thinks, I should make a choice to send my son and not my daughter? This is what we need to debate, that all we are advocating for is about equal opportunity. about choice. Let me address one question. There are several schools of thought, even in the feminist theory that we talk about. There are radical feminists who believe the problem is solely patriarchy. We need to overthrow that structure and just overturn it and ensure that men and women, you know, have equal opportunity, can make choice, whatever. There are radical people who believe like that. There are socialist feminists who think, well, there's a combination of male domination and other structural issues like money, control of assets, and whatever it is. Then there are those who liberal who believe the problem is actually nothing to do with male, nothing to do with the structure. It is prejudice.
Mm-hmm.
So we need laws. We need laws that that can give affirmative action, for instance. You know, you can work. You can make some legislation that, you know. So there are different. There are different schools of thought. Now I think all these schools of thought, no matter who drives them, no matter who believes in them, we need to come back to the very basics of dignity, opportunity, and choice for everybody, male or female. And this is not a struggle for women alone. It's a struggle for society.
We're going into a critical political season.
Mm.
And the discussion is again centering around that.
Mm.
And I started this... The context I was trying to set at the beginning of this discussion was the FDC party agenda that was launched on Monday, and the articulation of what the party, as a party, wants to do to appeal to the women constituency. Of course, if you take it broader, what Chris called opportunism is about the political stratification of society to be able to isolate particular constituencies. It might work in a political context. But if you look at the participation of women and the courting of the women constituency going into the electoral cycle, do you think the FDC agenda of Monday tries to address this concern, and you think that there will be an equal response, for example, from the other political players going into a critical election next year?
Well, I was in politics as... someone seeking to be elected. I know it's smart.
You contested an election.
Yes.
You won an election.
Yes,
contested and lost an election.
So, in terms of getting elected, it's always smarter to segment your voters.
Mm.
You know, it becomes easier to perhaps design messages for them, perhaps meet them. So, for purely electoral purposes, it's actually necessary to have an appeal for women, so to say, for men, so to say, for
youth.
Students, for so many groups in the constituency. So, but I don't think out there is really something that you can say that will be so unique for women. And most of the time, women vote as their men vote. There will be a sort of tendency in a certain population, a certain geography, that they will support, you know? So it doesn't really matter that you are going to design a message for women at a presidential level specifically and expect that it will be the winning ticket.
Mm.
That message must always try to embrace a woman and her husband and their children and their tribe and whatever. So it is wider than just women for the sake of FDC. But to appear to be clear on what they want to do for women for electoral purposes, I wish them luck.
Mm.
You see, Charles, before women say about FDC,
no, the broader politics.
Politics.
Really.
Mm. There is no disagreement here that there's something needs to be done for the woman.
Mm.
But for me, my preoccupation is building a functioning state. You cannot talk about women in Uganda today in a very hopelessly built state like ours. So talking about women will only be to serve temporal interests. And women are not homogeneous. So we have taken women to mean those who are able to shout. There are those who are now shouting as a means for their livelihoods, shout about other women. Women are not the same. They are women who are really downtrodden. And you can't even bring them up even using the current women activists, because they are well placed. And you see no result on the life of the poor woman. So they're in parliament. We talk about that, where a budget is passed. And they also keep lamenting. But they are okay. In Lesotho, because of several issues of apartheid, they went to a hill. Women were more educated. It hasn't made it, it hasn't made it a first world country. Women have PhDs in Lesotho. In Africa here, they have a higher per capita income of PhDs. They went to school as men were busy in the mines there.
Mm.
Doesn't change much. So it is always a strong state that responds to the needs of the citizens. So while we can try to give a voice to the other woman, we also must explain which woman are we talking about. I don't think I can be liberating Maria Chiwanuka because she has been sacked. I can't be fighting for her.
Mm.
I can't be fighting for Kadaga. Unless Kadaga has evidence that her fight for that girl in Alero. The girl in Alero doesn't even know what is a speaker. Because the education they have given to these children doesn't open them up. And they have the capacity to open them up. There is no power one can give a woman that the power of knowledge to make her choices. That's the point we are driving at. We are not disagreeing with us at all.
Mm. Yes.
So, but the point on FDC, whether FDC flags Adeke, flags Sebuao, flags who?
Alasso.
Flags Alasso. Still to address the point I'm telling you, that is for mere politicking. I don't think even they know what an ordinary FDC woman supporter goes through.
Mm-hmm.
So we need, this thing is wider. So if they are going to be used as toys to be present in a launch, mm-hmm. then we can say, yes, they were present. I am concerned with the well-being of ordinary woman.
Wouldn't it be the problem if you evaluate the content of their presentation itself?
Mm.
Does it speak to some meaningful content that can appeal to that woman in Alero?
But you see, the evidence here is there are many who have spoken the same content in the parliament. There's no improvement in the life of the woman. President Museveni, who's leading now, made women talk. You know, every woman actually says, he is our man, he has liberated us.
Mm-hmm.
That Museveni is their liberator. Can you imagine? Can you imagine today that Museveni is a liberator for women? When women, girls run out of school because when they reach a month of their bleeding, they can't get anything.
Mm-hmm.
And you say, some women have become agents of perpetuation of women's problems. That's what I'm saying. So let's address the issue as he's talking, while also informing those so-called activists that you're also serving a role dealing to the woman.
Arthur, there's this whole debate. We're going to go through constitution amendments soon in parliament.
Mm.
And the whole debate about, do you really still need a special affirmative action place for women? Mm. People have pointed to the Speaker of Parliament and said she has ring-fenced that position, I mean her constituency, as an affirmative action representative in parliament, even after rising to so many levels, having never sat in the back benches. And people asking, why don't you reconfigure that? Because, like Chris says, it continues the perpetuation of women's subjugation while appearing for political purposes as a liberation affirmative action for women. Isn't that something we need to confront?
No, there is a fundamental point that Chris makes about the nature, character of the state. Okay? Now, why is the Ugandan state considered to be failing in the first place? I would argue partly because of this macho mentality we have.
Is it just
partly? That's why I'm saying partly.
Mm-hmm.
Partly. I think an effective state. You reflect on the debates we had about the marriage and divorce bill in parliament and what happened and the kinds of sentiments, the emotions the media reported about what men were saying about property and stuff like that. Now, if you are led largely by the macho thoughts that we saw dominant in that debate, how else would you expect the state to be? I do believe, I agree with Chris, that reconstructing, having an effective state that delivers for men, women, everything is important. But why are we where we are needs to be debated. Now, I think, to be very honest with you, we don't need to ignore a fact of history. Regardless of where, whether you're talking about America, you're talking about Africa, you're talking about Uganda, women have come from a long way. There was a time they were not considered even as voters in Europe, in America, elsewhere. That has happened in history. And I cannot say that that the progress that has been registered to recognize that women have as equal opportunity to vote as any other is a joke. I don't think we might take it. We might take it as
maybe,
a
maybe they should justice. Have been kept out of voting in Uganda. They have kept themselves in forever.
No, no, no. You may think that. Now I think. No, just a second. Yes. Just me. I'm giving you an historical because we cannot simply debate. You know, as if it has happened. Mm. Nothing. We've come from far. Progress has been registered, and those progresses need to be consolidated. Chris talks about special circumstances that women of a certain age have to go through. This is a reality. It is a reality, and it needs to be responded to.
The question, like Chris is raising, is when the women now, if we isolate them as a group, have been given the vote, how effectively? Those who were given affirmative action to go to parliament, to sit on these committees, as a specific policy action policy action to get them on the team. How effective has it been used?
You see,
can we explore that after a short break?
Okay.
We'll be right back. Welcome to this last segment of the Fourth Estate, and we've been discussing women in politics with Chris Obore, Arthur LaRocque, Country Director of ActionAid Uganda, Honor Peter Komloit, Corporate Affairs Director, Nile Breweries, SAB Miller, and we've just been joined by Helen Kawesa. She's Public Relations Manager, Parliament of Uganda. We will drift in this discussion, this last segment, in the next 15 minutes, to discuss a decision taken by Parliament asking newsrooms to withdraw reporters who have been reporting in Parliament for 5 years and above. It's a decision taken by women, the chairperson of the Parliamentary Commission is the Speaker of Parliament. So that is the Honorable Rebecca Kadaga. It was communicated by the Clerk to Parliament, Jane Kibirige, another woman, and Helen is here to speak. So women politics think fixed. I thought you said you wanted to make one comment and then we'll transition into this discussion.
I think the simple comment I want to make is we should simply not trivialize the cause for women. We should realize that injustice in our society does exist and we need to do something about it. When you talk about affirmative action and how useful, is it still useful? Mm. I believe, given the context of where we are coming from, it has been useful. I still believe it is useful that women have come to parliament and people claim
and forgotten the women they left behind.
Actually, that nothing has changed is not because the women have failed, but because the system has failed.
So the burden
should not. Absolutely. Mm. And changing the system is not just a struggle for women, a cause for women, but a cause for all of us, because the struggle for the emancipation and dignity and choice for women is a struggle not for women but for society.
Exactly.
I think that's the bottom line.
But you see, Chris, let me ask a simple question.
Wait a moment, because we need to bring Helen into the discussion.
She's coming, but it's significant. Mm. You see, Arthur, I like that passion for human cause. I belong to that. But if you would ask me, or I ask you, the last presidential elections, we had Muriel Bot and Betty Kamia. How many elite women activists supported them? Such that there is no man on top who's undermining human cause.
Mm-hmm. So I think
they disappeared.
Okay.
Well, Kamia is still there to give testimony. Wait.
I'm afraid I'm going to censure that.
They gave it to Musei.
Helen, to this discussion. Maybe Helen should answer that question.
Mm.
I know working where your position might be a difficult question to respond to. Yes. But as a woman, and why, when issues of women are raised or when women step up to the plate, fellow women disappear.
And women are the majority.
Mm. Yeah, the majority. When fellow women come, you are the ones to let them down.
I don't think so. I don't necessarily agree that that's the case. I think that when women, I think that when women are at the top, in charge of affairs, there's a lot of criticism for them, for the women who are at the top, mostly from the men, of course.
Mostly from the women.
And from the women, yes, you have to be fair, and in when it's a woman or a man, regardless, you have to criticize them. But I think that when a woman is at the top managing affairs, there's a bit more attention that is paid to her as
Why
a woman.
Do you think so?
Because I think that the society we live in is dominated by men.
Is that why you didn't vote Kamia?
So you tend to think, the men tend to look at it as this is something different, and therefore it's more critical when
but
you're
but
there.
But in a
there's
country
more criticism.
That is dominated, I mean, majority of the voters in this country are women, and then you had two presidential candidates, both of them women, and there were no women backing their candidatures.
I don't think
isn't
that
there a problem there.
I don't think that the when it comes to voting, it's not a women issue. Voting is, you have a party or someone you believe in that this is a person who's going to take me forward. So you have a right to say whether it's a man or a woman, it's okay. And the women who go there to stand did not say that we want women to come and back us here. Yes, it's good that you back your fellow woman, but then when it comes to the issues, if you're following the issues, reading the letters in black and white, you go with the person whom you feel will represent you better.
Okay.
Yes. That's my view.
Let's move on this discussion. A decision was announced by the Parliament of Uganda. It has been interpreted or presented as an expulsion of journalists who have reported in Parliament for 5 years and above. Why was this decision made?
I think the decision was clear. The letter was clear. The letter which was written by the clerk to Parliament was communicating to the editors that there's been some concern about balanced reporting in Parliament. And the clerk to Parliament humbly requested the editors to look at the journalists who had been there for 5 years and reporters and replace them with new ones. It wasn't really an expulsion. It was really a change of guard, you could say. That this people have been here for five years.
So Parliament has sat and decided that it will select, it will manage newsrooms from Parliament and decide for newsrooms who gets to report from where?
No, it wasn't a decision.
So court will also make a decision and say, we want journalists who have only been here, we don't want journalists who have been here for more than more than 6 years.
What I wanted to say that the letter was written to the editors to do that. However, as I said, that the issue was that there'd been concern about the poor who had been overstayed at Parliament for some time.
But that looks to me like individuals, because
well, that's what I was coming. I was coming.
Be a group.
I was coming to that. Yeah. I was coming to that. That it was felt that some individuals, a number of them who had been there for a long time in Parliament, were becoming a bit irresponsible.
Then
they are reporting,
kind of what,
and therefore a decision was reached, and it was communicated to the editors.
Who made that decision?
I think the letter was clear. That clerk to Parliament wrote. She's a secretary to the Commission, and she's a CEO of Parliament. So she wrote on behalf of the Commission, and communicated that.
Was it a decision of the Parliamentary Commission?
The clerk to Parliament had discussions with members of the Commission.
So there was no meeting. There was no meeting of the Parliamentary Commission that made that decision. It
from
was a consultation process?
I did not sit on the commission myself, but that's what I'm hearing from the commission, that there was no meeting. But what I know is that the clerk had a discussion with members of the commission, whether it was an individual basis or whether it was in a meeting. But it allows for her as a chief executive officer to meet with some members of the commission and come to a decision, and it was communicated. If there's a problem with it, well, may have been in the communication that, but there was nothing saying it was a meeting. Letter does not say that we have had a meeting. It says the Parliamentary Commission feels this is the best way forward.
What does it say in your view to Parliament espousing ideals of democracy? To say that because you're uncomfortable with some journalists, you issue an edict that chases journalists out of Parliament?
I mean,
because they have reported, and someone called it, they have, because they have stayed in Parliament, reporting in Parliament for too long, they have adopted some kind of kamanyiro, if you can take it to that level.
I think that's not a personal decision, if someone that did say that or expressed that sentiment. But I think that it has now been, even last Thursday, the Speaker communicated that the letter had been stayed until further consultations take place within the Commission. I think that's now we are at that level. However, I would also want to say that at one point in time, we have an act which Powers and Privileges Act, which says that privileges and powers act, which says there's a the speaker can determine who is a stranger to parliament and who is not. So when we look, if you go into democratic issues, there's an act which may
I was doing some, I need to bring the gentleman into this discussion, but I was doing some consultation, and people believe that Speaker Rebecca Kadaga has gotten so much free way with journalists. They've been so positive to her that any slight criticism of her leadership of parliament evokes a reaction like the one she made. Because many people are saying, as chairperson of the parliamentary commission, she gave instructions to Jane Kibirige, the clerk to parliament, to write that letter and only through phone call consultations make a decision on how parliament is reported or who reports parliament.
The speaker, the clerk to parliament has not been around this week. She's actually coming in tomorrow. So we are going to have more detailed consultation with her on the issue of what exactly transpired. So as of now, we can't conclude that that was a fact. We can't conclude that it was a phone call, or you can't conclude it was this and this person on the other. So I think it's really premature to start coming up with those conclusions.
But the concern that possibly because the Speaker of Parliament has gotten so much positive coverage from the media that any she's averse to any criticism of any sort.
I don't think that's fair, because Parliament has had criticism all the way around. I mean,
Honor, you served in that parliament as as a member of parliament. You represented Damuria in that parliament, and you used to grace those corridors when you worked for the president. And you sent reporters to parliament and reported in from parliament. So this decision that because someone has been in parliament reporting for 5 years, then you think you write to a newsroom and say, change this person and send someone else. How does that help reporting of parliament and the questions of balance and fairness that Helen was talking about?
Look, certainly from my experience, I understand the feelings of people in parliament, perhaps the desire for positive coverage in a media sensitive society is not just limited to our parliament, it's not limited to Uganda. And institutions actually take a lot of measures to try and get positive coverage. So for me, I think the failure here was basically how would Parliament do this? Maybe writing a letter asking the editors to withdraw their reporters was a bit amateurish, I'm sorry to say. But that desire to control the outcome of the media reporting would be within their, you may call it selfish rights, but I think you did not manage it well, Helen. You maybe could have lobbied these editors individually.
Well, it didn't come from the public relations office, what I know.
I don't know. So it was poorly managed. And in the end, it looks like they don't want to be criticized. But I know a lot of institutions actually try to control the accreditation of people who cover them. I mean, these militaries embedding journalists, they choose whom to embed. They can refuse to accredit you. I'm sure even Western parliaments, Western state houses, like the White House, they don't just take in anyone. Okay. They can allege security reasons. So really here, unfortunately, it was just a poorly managed desire for positive media coverage.
Chris, you've commented about this decision. Where do you think it came from, and how does it bode with the relationship between parliament, and especially the Speaker of Parliament, and media houses going forward?
I don't think this thing should be boiled down to the Speaker of Parliament. Rebecca has had her own issues, but I don't think this should be blamed on her. First, this position is very difficult for me to talk about, because one, it has both the positive and the negative. the positive is that, the negative is that journalism is supposed to operate without any influence. And growing journalists in their beats of influence is very important. How you find a journalist who has reported White House throughout their life, they've been there. So the beauty of that is that it gives you an in-depth writing about that particular institution. So from that perspective, journalists require to grow in parliament, become experts in that reporting, and then they're not supposed to be shuffled anyhow. Now and today, this is where another one. But the context here is different. First of all, that parliament is suffering from the worst public relations ever. With all due respect, I don't think there's any public relations in that parliament. It is the one you can see any nonsense coming from. There is even no effort for us to know what an MP is supposed to be doing. So those MPs are sometimes they are project officers. They are, we don't know who they are. Now people don't know an MP is their wealth representative in Kampala. So all that should be coming from a PR office to keep telling people, you see, an MP is supposed to do this. It should be known to every citizen. I think that's why they should have a PR office. But I think people, I don't know your constraints.
You're loading so much but on the public relations function
listen,
of parliament.
Please, there's a reason why they have it. You see, public relations, we take it in Uganda as just an office and then signing letters. There's more to internal communication and, you know, this. No! Public relations actually to bridge a gap between the institution and the public. Now, as I will tell you, Ugandans are terribly ignorant about the role of their MP. That is already a PR failure. So MPs are trying on their own, each one to do their PR, to explain what their role is. That's already a problem. The institution should be helping MPs to do that. But they have failed. Now, the other problem is by them asking to withdraw, and Peter has explained very well, it was also an amateurist PR strategy. You can't be so naive. You're supposed to be dealing with the public, and then you say, we are withdrawing. Yes, you have the power, you have the law, but journalism is a noble profession. You don't direct it. The only thing is, these MPs seem to have a genuine reason. And we journalists should not simply keep saying, those are MPs. I know they are hopeless, they are just bogus looking for money, they are what? But we shouldn't also be bogus, that we use our privileged position to keep them look bogus, even when they're supposed to be bogus. There are 400 MPs in that house. I don't know the number, you must be knowing. But I'm telling you, if you want to read a story about parliament, it's about 10 MPs.
386.
It's about 20 MPs you keep hearing about. That is an indictment on how to report parliament. If they are stupid, if others can't talk, show LaRocco that this one is stupid. But how will he know if he has not read about them? If I'm only given a platform. So that's why parliament has a genuine reason. And we must know when political actors meet, however strong you are as a journalist, you can't overturn them easily. They have interests. Now, these people have thought over time. Why are we, and the problem, Charles, also is you have been in the newsroom, you have been an editor yourself. Assign a reporter to get a parliament story, the same people. I can quote, Sechikubo, Katuntu, it stops there. So yeah, it is a monotony of who speaks from parliament. Why? And there's no journalist who has been stopped. There's a directory of all members of parliament, their constituencies.
And their phone numbers.
Why their phone numbers? Why don't you vary them? If this one has spoken in a stupid manner, then the public knows that this one is stupid. But we have decided to call them stupid without them being heard.
Without giving them the opportunity.
Yes, and some MPs, just to support and some MPs, just as you come in, journalists today are becoming aides to MPs. It's a matter of LaRocco picking one journalist, taking them to Gulu, put them there in a hotel, eat them and say, this is my constituency. The next day, flashed MP LaRocco. He has done a road. He has done a bridge. Then they go and
isn't
say,
that also an indictment on the new, on the editors? You who deploy them.
Exactly. So, let there be evidence that the news organizations are actually doing something to address concerns arising from parliament.
Okay.
Rather than simply saying, it's our duty.
Then before I come back to you, you criticize the public relations office of parliament and again praise them, because I think you made available, I consult the parliament website, especially for contact numbers for members of parliament. And whenever someone calls me and says, please give me Honorable So-and-so's number, I say, but it's available on your computer. Why do you need to?
But just before Ellen comes in, I wanted to sort of supplement what I was saying. I was also a bit suspicious about the reaction of our friends in the media. Parliamentary Association.
Yes.
I mean, they reacted in a way which was quite suspicious. You know, they were almost lynching the MPs. They did not also try to say, look, did our newsrooms actually even have anything? They were saying we shall not cover these people. Mm. And so I think maybe giving credence to all these stories about what happens in parliament, that there's some kind of inbreeding of corruption between the MPs and the guys who cover them.
A quick comment and then I'll come back to Helen because our time is short. We need to be getting out of here. There are two levels of this. There might be the indiscipline and the kamanyiro of journalists who have been covering parliament for a long time because they know the corridors, because they know the MPs, and take the friendship or the contacts they have created beyond acceptable limits. There is a question about what Chris talks about, trips. Selecting of which journalists travel with the speaker, with the deputy speaker, with which members of parliament, internally and externally. I have had that come out as a major issue of contention. But the journalists
foreign
are claiming
travel.
Yes, foreign travel is big problem. And then Chris puts it right. You cannot have a parliament that only reports a particular number of members of parliament. I mean, particular MPs featuring. The rest of the MPs, by the way, have their journalists in the constituencies who cover them for the local media, for local radio stations. Those are valid concerns that arise. But how can parliament sit and decide who gets fielded? Because it's like FIFA deciding which players express fields for the Super League. Or FIFA deciding in a World Cup contest which players get fielded. I thought that was a little bit over the top.
I think the discussion borders on, I think it really reflects a crisis of professionalism in different spaces, both in the media and in the way institutions are run. I think it is whether the journalists were doing something wrong or something unacceptable. I don't think it is Parliament's call. It's not their judgment call. I think it should have been the media houses to refresh their reporting if they so desire. So I think there is something to this story that that is not professional, both in the way it is handled by Parliament, but also in the specific circumstances that, in my view, led to that emotional letter, I think.
Okay. Helen, you've heard all the comments. I need to start with Chris, who says your public relations function as Parliament is wanting significantly.
It's unfortunate. His comments are unfortunate because they hinge a lot on the educating the public about the role of MPs and spending